young researchers, scholars, to make a guess. And as Professor Rajkumar has rightly said, those who really are the reservoir of institutional memory and institutional understanding, like Ms. Margarita and my wonderful friend Sudarshan. It has really been a privilege and a great honor to have accepted this invitation to give Law Day lecture. I don't know whether to call it lecture or not, but it has been prescribed like that, that I have to give Law Day lecture. It is only persuasive power and very charming style of this great dynamic young vice chancellor who can lead hordes of vice chancellor that made me to accept this invitation. I was down with 103 fever, and only yesterday at noon I thought, how do I come out of the chart? I would love to have more romance to the chart. So excited. But let me share with you, I was very nervous. And I was very nervous to accept this invitation, not because of the inabilities, some of which are self-created. Like I suffer from acute crisis of time management, and I suffer from acute lack of e-science. So I was too nervous that should I accept this invitation, and more so, knowing full well, and move to a place which is a hub of researchers, scholars, academics, institutions. And I can nowhere come near. But then it's my great temptation of meeting this great hub, meeting these intellectuals, and drawing some inspiration at this last day of life, that I accepted this invitation. Once again, my thanks to Mr. Rajkumar, faculty, and young scholar for having me, for having given me this opportunity. Though there is some text here, but we present you this order is done, and whatever is the text, it is absolutely general, elementary, disorderly. Therefore, I hope you will pardon me if I impose upon you that disorderly, elementary understanding of mind of importance of this day. As Professor Rajkumar has rightly pointed out, many in this country, till today, Professor Rajkumar, you may even run a quiz and you will be distressed that 90% responses would be incorrect. Most of the people in this country believe that 26th November 1949 is a day we adopted the Constitution. Though 65 years ago, this day, after hard work of 2 years, 11 months, and 7 days, that the drafting committee completed its work, and therefore remaining, whether it is late December of 49 or it is 26th of January those two are more ceremonial events. The event which deserves to be celebrated more is today's day. And I wish at some point of time, instead of calling it a law day, we call it a constitution day. And I can show you, I realize that I'm making a mistake. I had printed the word constitution. But then I saw your invitation card and I realized, no, I should not commit that blunder. See, some 65 years ago we completed this work. In more than 60 years, we have functioning democracy. What made it possible to happen? It is this text, it is this constitution which we are celebrating today. It is this constitution which guided the destiny of the nation in all ups, downs, good days, bad days, terrible days, days of tension and days of glory. Whether shining India or dark India, it is this constitution which stood the test of time. Many other institutions failed, but it is this document which served the destiny, which stood the test of the time, and therefore many times it has been described as oasis of rights, representation, and justice amongst a huge desert of large number of flailing, failing, and flawed states in the neighborhood. And therefore, we need to salute the completion of that work of those 270 big people, our parents, who gave us this. No doubt, if India's democracy has been hailed all the world because of this constitution, as not only the largest, but one of the most vibrant and one of the most happening democracy, is largely due to this constitution. But equally it is to be accepted that 65 years have also been years of terrible violence, sometimes in the name of religion, sometimes in the name of nationalism, sometimes in the name of caste. 65 years have also seen, despite of growth, iniquity still pervades instead of prevalence in many respects. It is expanding. 65 years have also seen that dignity, human dignity, has always been at the receiving end. I'm sure more than me, you can read out the statistics. Just last week, a report has been released and it said that India has highest number of modern slaves. That is, those indulging in prostitution, bonded labor, unpaid labor, or so on and so on. And therefore, it is not that 65 years have been all the time a golden age. But I'm not looking into good and bad. The point I wish to stress here is that whatever is this gloominess I'm narrating cannot be subscribed to constitutionally. we might have failed our constitution. People might have vandalized, mutilated, violated, ignored, ruthlessly ruptured constitutional values. That doesn't mean that values are no good. That doesn't mean constitution is no good. Think for a second. If we did not have this constitution, what would have happened? Okay, Britishers had left us. We didn't have this constitution. And we have created some other constitution. I'm sure that would have led India into being another colony, either of communist, narrowist, militarists, or narrow interests. Therefore, it is always better to have a beautiful constitution than to have no constitution or a constitution which is only in the name of constitution. Therefore, I strongly believe that today is a day, as Professor Rajkumar rightly put it up, needs to have celebration of more grandeur. Of course, but this is a day which is to be celebrated not only at India Day, not only unfurling the flag, not only the state showing its power on Rajpath. This is a day you and I who claim that we are students of the Constitution need to understand, need to take stock of where, what went wrong, how went wrong, what could be done to preserve the constitutional scheme. And as I mentioned a moment ago, that most of the failings are not because of constitution, because either we failed to defend constitutional values, or we fail to secure and promote those values. That most of the problems arose. And therefore, and Professor Rajkumar asked me to speak on this theme, defending constitutional values for democratic governance, despite my all nervousness. Let my colleagues make up my poor knowledge or unpreparedness, but I cannot ignore participating in celebration of this moment, because we are all sitting here and talking about defending constitutional values for democratic governance. Now this is the day, today is the day when we all stakeholders in the democracy, not only we as individuals, but those who occupy institutional positions, those who are in positions of power and authority, they all need to commit themselves that they will always be in the vanguard of defending constitution. I think judiciary has been assigned the final and the ultimate responsibility of defending constitution values. How far the judiciary has stood the test of the time. That's a question which needs to be examined. I think this is a day which requires us to at least put this proposition in our mind. Because what happens many times is only one-sided praise And many times, not even condemning the rise of a kind of judicial culture, which, according to me, belittles the dignity of judicial institution itself. I'll come to this point a moment later. But I think it is one thing which is very important. Apart from judicial, the legislature and the political executive as the greatest role in securing and defending constitutional values. And that is where the real crisis of failure of democratic governance or vandalization of constitutional values arise. We have been talking so much of liberalization, we have been talking about so much loosening of the system. Prime Minister holding hours long meeting directly with the secretaries, but the fact of matter is, whichever be the color, kind, size, ideology of the political executive, it will most of the time remain strangled in the hands of the office. They are too smart, they are too intelligent, they are too clever. Unfortunately, that smartness, cleverness, and intelligence they are failing to use in defense of constitutional values, rather letting it loose to suggest bureaucracy how to circumvent those constitutional values. No doubt, there are other democratic institutions like the Election Commission of India. Recently, till 10 years ago, hardly many knew that there is some bird sitting at Rao's Avenue called CAG. But today, Election Commission, CAG, CEC, I don't know, should I call it CDI or not, but these are some important institutions which are responsible to ensure that you and I are governed by a democratic governance which is committed to constitution. No doubt, institutions like Election Commission, particularly after session, did perform its role and perform its role quite satisfactory. But CAG too, in the recent past, has risen all kinds of questions and did a good job. Unfortunately, other two institutions which are included in the list of important institutions like CBC and CBI have recently come under serious threat from the judiciary, and therefore this is the day we need to understand structure, restructure, regeneration of these institutions. So if today is the day for judiciary to commit itself, for political executive and the state to commit itself, institutions to commit itself, but the greater, larger, and most important commitment to constitutional values has to come from the real sovereign, and that is we the people are the political sovereign, questioning how much we are committed to constitutional values, how much do we love democratic governance, how can we rise above caste, religion, language, particularist loyalties that will determine how perfect is the defense of these values. And in my year of 1977, it is this legal, political sovereign, which got the chance, first chance, and the utility of chance in all the leverage in their hands. Today, Twitter, computer, 24/7. Media, election commission, going to schools, colleges, asking people to go and vote. And then you know to take pride, 67% voting, 80% voting, 75%. There was no such system, but people came in hopes, voted out. Why? Because they were convinced that she could not care about constitutional values. And that the government seeking, maybe it was very effective, maybe it was very focused, maybe it was development oriented, but the governance itself was undemocratic and unconstitutional. Maybe Supreme Court at some stage might have said the declaration of emergency was constitutional. But no, people that they said gave their verdict, it was unconstitutional. And therefore, to me, to prove that kind of love, romance, and commitment with constitutional value is very crucial. Mr. Rajkumar, I have a serious question here, and a very difficult question. With this all IT boom, with this all great economic boom, 10 years in India, having growth rate, stable growth rate, and definitely a growth rate, which would not have been possible after what happened to Goldman Sachs. India is still continuing its growth story, but jobless growth, growthless job, all these questions come to my mind, and I think today's I'm not making any negative statement. For God's sake, I should be forgiven if it's something like this. This post-1991 generation, and if you look to India's demography, they constitute a very significant proportion of voting population. And children, they are very aspirational, they are very demanding, they are very assertive, they want accountability, they want transparency. These are all good. I'm not disputing. Taking advantage of this and taking advantage of IT boom, you will see a government came to power using our act. I'm not talking about that. My problem is somebody else. And I want someone to seriously decide to reflect that this generation, post-1991 generation, is not the generation of Mother India. It is not the youth of Mother India. It is not the youth of Diwar. It is the youth of the bomb. It is the youth which is so self-determined and so self-focused. Now, how much do they care for constitutional values? It's a serious question. No doubt, thousands of them coming to Rice and Arrow, or thousands of them coming to Ramadan or Anna Hazare, is a positive signal. But do you think all that happened because they have deep faith in constitutional values and therefore to me, it's more crucial that my generation might have cheated, defeated, violated constitutional values, but at least inside we felt ashamed that what we are doing is bad. I wonder whether, and it is not their mistake, it is not their fault, because they have never been told. And therefore, my impression is that in this post-1911 generation and the upcoming generation is serious issue. After having made one of these general remarks, I'm not taking 15 minutes because 35 minutes was my agenda. I'm taking 25 minutes, so maybe I'm taking 30 minutes. Professor Rajkumar, not only a charming and persuasive style of inviting people. Of course, I am then to be invited. I must all right. If we can have steam here in the faculty, we can have ambassador in the faculty, if we can have solution in the faculty, and if we can invite today, as I mentioned to you, only two persons. One, we lost very recently, Grammy last year. The professor. But for these two to talk authentically about constitution is showing a blow to the center. And I'm very conscious of what to learn. But as I have mentioned, there's a great charm of throwing googlies also. See, googly has a charm. Because you think you're going to read six. And what happened? Either I beg you or you get one. So when he gave me this theme, initially I thought, yes, it is very simple. But more I thought of it, more I realized that no, it is Rajkumar's style, it is a googly. It's very complex, complicated, very comprehensive. At least I don't have that kind of shoulder language and information store on my head that I can deal with kind of complexity and comprehensiveness. Because here is a topic which demands you to look into economic, historical, sociological, cultural, and all kinds of perspectives into 65 years of development on one side. And second, it demands that you have to necessarily examine your study. You have to compulsorily reflect upon the present. And you have to definitely tell how to make tomorrow. And I was thinking, I was reminded of a great philosopher who long back said that those who cannot make future, they won't be excellent. And he said, now that's achieved. That I have to look at the present, I have to look at the
past,
I have to say something about the future. In my paper, I have made some attempt and given me a bullet point. That was before I gave you a bullet point. Isn't it right? That if you look to the past, past is full. And this one will have long history. This is incredible. By no record could ever have been said or can be said that she was not one of the most important. I'm not saying loved. I'm saying not one of the most important leader of the world, in particular. She was a courageous woman. She did not hesitate to support the cause of division, Pakistan, creation of Bangladesh. She did not bother to nationalize banks, withdraw to the person. I'm not talking of merits. I'm simply saying a great, courageous woman. And by any reckoning, she might have created right or wrong impression that she was working for poor. But what happened? What happened? Such a powerful leader was made not only to lose her election, her son was, because the nation was convinced that he is a lady on whose hands the Constitution is not safe, values are not safe. Forget about her. Her own son, Rajiv Gandhi, who came to power with such a many majority, he had to lose his power. And why? Because of all allegations, but this is how the society behaves, that people started believing that here is a man who we thought is a modern mind, scientific mind, liberal mind, another, but here is a man who is more close, here is a man who lacks probity, and probity is antithesis of rule of law. No, lack of probity in governance is a sure route to either government becoming undemocratic, government becoming brutalized, or government losing its credibility and ultimate legitimacy. He was UPA 2, 2009, Congress increased its own, became very powerful and did many things. On record, I can say, did many things which were positive in nature. But what happened? Unfortunately, for that government, each one brought a new scam. Some of the ministers, they even give up the mean authority of constitution. Like CH. Many ministers, day in and day out, will talk of minority. Appeasement, talk of all kind of wonderful idea or wonderful reservation. I'm meant to speak in presence of man who has done India's positive, affirmative discrimination law of beautiful history. But now, what happened? These are all messages which were taken by people as loss of faith in constitutional value, and they defeated all these three reasons. Let me also tell you, it is not a question of majority. Indira Gandhi had 2/3 majority, Rajiv Gandhi had 2/3 majority. I know discomfort with the kind of numbers he was having in parliament. But where the catch comes, even this government, today's government, BJP's government, we call it NDA government, but it is led by BJP. And BJP in itself has more than absolute. They don't have, they now don't require, or they cannot be given the liberty of coming out with argument of coalition compulsion. Right? Now here is a government which employs so much majority. They should realize that majority was with Indira Gandhi, majority was with Rajiv Gandhi, majority was with Manmohan Singh, plus that. And therefore, what is important is not majority. What is important to earn this confidence of people that are committed people who are working for constitution, values, and democratic governance. This majority should not lead to confrontation. This majority should not lead to unnecessary, unwanted controversies. There is need to develop a consensus. There is need for this majority party to control its own member who in NDR are talking the language of hate, talking the language of one religion, no religion, or one day German, one day Sanskrit. This kind of approach completely defeats India's constitution, promotion of multiculturalism, diversity, secularism, fraternity, and I think it's not a question of majority, it is a question of building consensus around the issue. And thanks God that till this day, Prime Minister himself has not made any statement or has not taken any action supporting these things. But that also sometimes compounds the problem. Politics of science will be the worst politics. And here is a moment for this government to think. It is not a question of majority and consensus building. It is a question that, you know, another 3 minutes in action, that 65 years ago, this work was completed. India had changed. And India had changed a lot. And if it had changed a lot, think 47 years, even 15, later in 15, India was a feudalistic society. The majority of population illiterate, when I'm using the word illiterate, I'm using it in a literal sense, illiterate. Ignorant, exploited, ignored, marginalized, right? When you have that kind of scenario today, a great transformation. India today boasts of economic growth. India today boasts of expanding middle class. India today boasts of foreign investment. Boosts on reducing number of people, and yet the boosts on meaning, I need not say a word, no. But question is, values are individual. Values should not, cannot, must not be compromised. But that does not mean that democracy, democratic governance would not require regeneration or reform and creating new institutions. And therefore, if democratic governance has to be a goal, it is crucial that these reforms and changes are followed. You know, I just in government, I don't have a habit of more legitimacy in our democratic institutions. Because to me, these democratic institutions are losing their legitimacy. What happened to CBC, CBI, what happened to CBC, and kind of allegations you are hearing, right or wrong, about judiciary, about police. So therefore, to me, that they require to be small in terms of giving more legitimacy to democratic institutions, which are lacking. And unless we do democracy itself, and maybe at the end, constitution itself will become effective. And I'm reminded, I just asked Dr. Sudarshan, he's an encyclopedia. So I asked Prof. Sudarshan, can you remind me what is the first book Francis Fukuyama wrote? And he said, End of History. Many people at that time did not believe. And now, I don't know whether believers have converted or others have converted. I don't want to go into his that work. I simply want to say that in his latest work, which he brought out in 2013, Political Order and Political Others and Political Decay, he talks of this investment of legitimacy into institutions. And I read only five sentences that he wrote. What he said, liberal democracy remains the best system for dealing with the challenges of modernity. And there is little reason to believe that Chinese, Russian, or Islamist alternatives can provide the diverse range of economic, social, and political goods that all humans crave. But unless, that is the crucial message which we have. But unless liberal democracies can somehow manage to reform themselves, combat institutional decay, history will end with an end. In the history, history will end with a bang. But a history will end not with a bang, but with a resounding impact. If others say that all political systems past and present, all political systems, past and present, are liable to be as older institutional structures fail to evolve to meet the needs of changing world, the political world. And therefore, it's very crucial that instead of decaying, we think of a reform. In this paper, I've said many more things, but hang about the same thing. that even when we talk of rupa, the entire emotion must be rooted in constitution values. Otherwise, the forms or the circle of the forms will have no meaning. And when you look at yourself, institution, the latest example of the social media. The university which I left 3 years ago, where I instituted this online, this, I just put a message half an hour ago saying, sir, what you did, we are taking it further, and we are holding a special on social media. And now, please mark, do you have social media brought a revolution? Social media created Occupy Wall Street. Social media created Occupy, the commercial nerve of Hong Kong. It created Ramlila Maidan. It created Rising Hill. But same created Muzaffarnagar, Krishna Nagar in Delhi. Do we have institution? And therefore, thinking and talking of these on this is very, very crucial. I have no words to say my deep apologies for burning you in my complete disorder. What I have spoken and what I have written are altogether different. And therefore, I really feel absolutely guilty of having taken on a life which I don't deserve. Right? I hope you will pardon me and you will not blacklist me from any writing in the future. Thank you very, very, very much, Mr. Rajkumar. And thanks to yourself, Margaret. Your presence has been great inspiration and at the same time great disciplining fact. Thank you very, very much. I enjoyed it.